had this Big Muff for a while, and I never really liked the way that it sounded. And I was working on this mod, and I was like, you know what? I had a difficult time finding some stuff online, like how to actually do this, I guess, and what it would really accomplish. My understanding is that the way that the tone knob works out on this model, if this looks familiar to you, this is, you know, it's a pretty popular model. But the tone knob on this one works. So if you have it all the way on bass, it's going to reduce the treble to simulate making it very bassy. And just the opposite, if you have it all the way on treble, it's going to reduce the bass to make it more trebly. It's also scooping the mids, so even if you have it set to center, it's still going to have a very scooped mid sound to it, which, you know, sometimes that's nice, but other models also have this tone wicker thing that lets you disengage this tone knob, and that's what this mod is trying to do. A way to get around it that I've kind of done is to put like an overdrive pedal or like a DS1 or something. You know, that orange dirt pedal that like everyone has, and you can put that in front of the Big Muff, and then you can kind of adjust the tone frequency that you want on that, and you can kind of derive the mids a little bit more out of this. It's pretty much where I'm at. So I just disassembled and disconnected the face plates, and I'm following these instructions from StuMac. I got a kit from them.
Future Sugarwiggy here. So I was not aware when I was recording that part, but StuMac actually makes the instructions available for free online as like a PDF. So yeah, you don't have to buy the kit. That was actually kind of one of my main motivations. I was like, oh, I should probably get it, you know, with everything I need, plus like the instructions, because I heard they were really good. And I completely agree, by the way. The instructions are excellent. It's pretty much, you know, everything that you need to know. They even like cover some like soldering basics if you've never soldered or you don't have a lot of experience soldering. So they kind of go over that a little bit. But yeah, this is free. You can literally just like Google Big Muff Pi tone bypass StuMac instructions or something like that, and it should show up. I'll have a link down below with everything that you need, including the actual stuff that you get. And this is actually pretty much it right here. Anyway, back to the video.
You gotta take off like the knobs, the instrument inputs, outputs, the power switch, pretty much everything except for the LED. If it's glued on, I don't think every model is, but if it is, they say just leave it. And so yeah, this is the guts right here. Then you take a quarter inch drill bit. This isn't one, it's the closest I had. And you stick a hole right between the tone sustain, is what they say. And then the switch that comes with the kit goes right here. So that's the goal. Yeah, that's pretty much where I'm at. So what is actually included in the kit? I don't believe it's very, I'm out of focus. Okay, so what actually comes in the kit, I don't believe is super expensive. It's probably only a couple bucks to buy individually.
Just chiming in after checking some of this out, it might actually make more sense if you don't have a lot of this stuff just lying around to buy a kit, because a lot of these components are going to be sold in pretty large quantities and it might end up being more expensive, so just keep that in mind.
I'm going to look and see if I can find like the same stuff, and I'll post it. Really all it is this switch right here. It has three prongs, or here, this is the schematic if you can see it. And they give you like a little bit of wire, it's not much, in black and white. And they also give you this insulation rubber stuff, which I don't believe is completely necessary. If you have electrical tape, you could probably do the same exact thing. I think it's nice though, because the way that I've soldered this on right now, if the wires are connecting, then the switch is not gonna do anything. So you do wanna make sure that there's no metal connection, so that way a current is not bridging that and making the switch no longer a switch. So they say to cut off, for each of these prongs here that you gotta connect it to, 2 4-inch length of wire, and then you just strip the ends off. You solder 2 into this one right here, and then 2 into the middle, and then you just make sure that that connection, whoop, right in between there isn't being bridged. Yeah, so I got the heat shrink solder joints. It's saying, all right, we did that. Oh, it gives us hints on this. It's telling me I should probably get an open flame and like actually heat shrink this on here. I have fire. Okay, so yeah, let's do the fire thing. I think this works. Okay, cool. I think I did it. Oh yeah, breathe into those fumes. Delicious. Okay, good stuff. I don't know. I think I did it. So anyway. Okay, now we gotta do technical stuff. By technical stuff, I mean I think I just have to find, like, a thing that I have to remove. And I don't actually, like, have, like, the right tools exactly, but I'm gonna try to make it work anyway. Perfect. Yep, that's good. Good stuff. So it says, the location of this capacitor varies by model. Shit, I have to read this. Oh, okay. So I have a big code right here that says EC3003 REV-E. The last letter in that code, A, B, C, D, or E, so I have the E version, is the version I have. Now I have to locate capacitor C8. It will be either yellow or green. On version A or B, C8 will be between the volume and tone ports. You know what, this, I feel, is probably very important information, and obviously they're not paying me to do this. You know, if you want to, you absolutely can. But just for the instructions alone, even though the components are very cheap, you can probably do this for like only a couple bucks if you have all the tools that you need. But the instructions are really good, and if you don't want to fuck up your Big Muff, you know, you might as well at least try to do it right, I guess. That was why I bought it, even though I knew I could have just tried to do this and, like, jerry-rigged it my own way. Okay, so on my version, C, D, or E, the C8 is located between the tone and sustain pots. Yeah, okay. So, tone and sustain pots here. On this version, desolder and lift the leg of C8 that is closest to the sustain pot, which I believe is this one. I'm just double checking. Okay, let's see if we... Oh, here it is. It's right there. I believe this is it. C8. So it wants me to desolder just one side of it. And feel free to call me out on my technique here. I don't claim to be great at soldering. I've done a bit with basically most of my experience with soldering comes from fixing or trying to fix different chips for Bitcoin miners of all things. So, but the correct way I think to do this is to actually use like a desolder thing, and I've actually never used one of those before. Okay, new plan of approach here. We're gonna put this slightly beneath the leg that needs to get taken out so we can get leverage. And then we're going to go for that again until it starts getting a little wiggly. I'm just gonna hold it there for a second until I can see the solder start to bubble out a little bit. Oh, there we go, that's working. Okay, so I think I got it. Yep, there we go. And I believe what we're going to end up doing is soldering one end of this guy. Sorry, I needed to be able to see what was going on, so I apologize if you weren't able to see a whole lot of that guy right there. I don't have the best camera situation, so I do apologize, I'm trying. Okay, we got another 1-inch length of heat sink over one of the black wires. Well, about that, I may have lost. Oh, here it is, okay. So I need another inch or so. So let me get my knife out here. That looks like an inch, right? Sure. Perfect. It wants me to take one of the black wires and we'll put the heat shrink on one of them. And I assume this is the one that we're going to solder directly onto C8 right there. Yep, that is exactly what we're gonna do. Okay, so I'm gonna slip that all the way down so it's out of my way. And he's a tiny little guy. I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna make a little loop here so I can wrap this end of the wire around that leg. Let's see. There we go. Oh, it's perfect. Little tiny loop. And then, yeah, we'll connect it. I'll slip it over the leg right there. I really should have gotten those needle nose pliers, but I'm stubborn and I don't want to get up at this point, so we're just gonna fendangle it. And we're going to solder that. Let's give it a shot. Start with the shaking.
I drink a lot of coffee. It's a good thing I'm not gonna be a surgeon though, right? Okay. Let's see if that's secure on there. I mean, I don't really think it's gonna get a whole lot better than that. Let me just try to smooth it out a little bit. Oh no, I'm gonna have to slide that shrink wrap stuff over it. And then I think I can set it on fire again. Yeah, there we go. Okay, you know what? For this part, I am seeing the purpose of the shrink wrap. I mean, I still feel like you could do it with electrical tape. I just think it would be probably easier to do this, the shrink wrap method here. I think that's honestly not a bad idea. There we go. That's what I was supposed to do, right? So we're on to the next step, which is find resistor R5. Whatever the fuck that means. So if my version is A or B, it'll be located between the tone and sustain pots. I don't have that version. On C, D, and E, it'll be below, right below the one that we were just messing with. Okay. Oh, there it is, right there. R5. For me and my version, it is, if you can see it, that guy right there. So I assume I'm gonna have to do something similar here. Locate the leg closest to the sustain pot, which is, I believe it's this one. All right, this guy right here. So on my version, I have the E version. So this is the one that we just messed with, and now it wants me to go for R5. I think I have to do the same thing. Wait, maybe I don't. For all versions, locate the leg closest to the sustain pot and, okay, and desolder lift it. So we're gonna have to do the desolder thing again. So I'm gonna do the same thing where I did before, where I slid one leg of my tweezers under the leg I want to lift so I can get leverage. And I just have to find the corresponding one on the back, and they are labeled on the back, which makes this a little bit easier. Shit, I lost it. All right, I see it. So on the back of the board, it is this guy. I'm gonna do pretty much the same thing here and just kind of wiggle this around until the solder becomes like liquid. And now that it is, I'm gonna just push it a little bit. I can feel it going, sort of. I'm gonna pull up. Okay, nope, that didn't do it. Let's try again. Oh, did I do it? Yep, I did it, okay. So I have to attach another black wire to R5. Just like we did before with C8, we're gonna do exactly the same thing, I believe. I'm gonna use just a little tiny one. I feel like that ought to be enough to cover the joint. Okay, so let's cover it. And I just got to solder it. Okay, so remove that, get that out of the way. Okay, so I am going to do the same thing like I did before and turn this into like a loop. And that way, hopefully, I can just slide it over the leg of this guy. All right. So we did that. Definitely think that like having some small pliers would be very helpful. The tweezers are okay, but they're not strong enough for me to like, I wanna crimp this wire right here, but I like can't get in there right now. So I might not be able to do that, but you know what? I'm gonna lengthen it out and then I'll just solder it like that. And that should be fine. Got my little soldering nub here. I think that's good, I just don't want to move, so I'm gonna put a little bit more on the side here. Oops, oh shit. Just dropped it on the cutting board. A little piece of solder there. Oh man, my iron might be a little bit too hot here. Maybe. It's just like rolling right off. Here, I turned it down a little bit. There. Struggling here. Alright, there we go. Perfect. Well, when I say perfect, I mean good enough for me. If it works, it works. That's really all I care about. Yeah, that's still a little bit hot. One thing I will say is my particular kit came with these, I don't know, these wires. The insulation is almost like cloth.
So it made stripping them very annoying. Okay, I just got to push this over. Light the shit on fire again. Am I doing this right? I have no idea. I think I am, but I've been wrong before. C8 is just bent completely now. I really think I might need to tape that. And I got some electrical tape. Okay, so there. Let me just get like a little baby piece here. Just a little guy. Now he has a little bit of support. I think the other one's gonna be okay. That one, I feel like the connections for the feet are very thin. And I feel like if you bend it back and forth a couple more times, I'm not gonna be having a good day after that. More coffee. I gotta install the white wires. What it is saying here is install the white wires, solder the free end of the white wires to the hole. All right, okay, I see. I'm literally going to plug one of these guys in. What do I do? Hold on, I just gotta fandangle it a bit. Okay, so literally gonna stick it in the hole where that one leg is like lifted up. And I'm gonna do the same with the other one. I'm gonna do the one by R5 first, because I don't know, I feel like that's gonna be easier. I don't know what I'm doing yet. See, I think the wire might actually be too thick for me to do it this way, so. Problem is, at least on this one, is that there is a little bit of solder on the other side. And I think I need to clear that out. I think it's this one. All right. So, I think that hole is big enough for me to shove that wire through it now. Yes, yes it is. All right, there we go. Sticking out a bit much. I don't like have dedicated wire cutters, so hopefully this works. Yeah, no. So otherwise I'm just gonna have like a big connection sticking out the back there, and that's kind of what I'm worried about. I don't see any other connection that could cause problems with, so I'm just gonna bend it. Hope for the best. I really do hope this works. I really hope I'm not just gonna mess my pedal up. Yeah, my new song that I just put out, or I'm going to put out there, use this pedal. Before I did this though, so it's got the whole tone scoopy thing. If I remember correctly, I usually would use the DS1 to kind of like shape the tone a little bit, but I ended up doing EQ to dial in some of those mids, especially because the sound I was going for, I was kind of like messing with, there we go. I was kind of messing with synths, and getting synths and the sound of like a Big Muff to fit into a mix was kind of difficult, especially when all the mids are like really scooped. I'm gonna do the same thing with the other one. To get it to fit in the mix better, I added a ton of mids back. And it seemed like it helped. I mean, I feel like it works. I've also seen some people use a wah pedal to kind of help with that too. I don't know if I can bend this the same way that I did the other one. We're gonna try. Bend. There we go. It's bent. Add a little bit more solder in there. I think this is it though. I pretty much think that that is the mod, I'm pretty sure. I think I just need to put it all back together now. Which will totally be easy. 100%, I'm not gonna struggle with that at all. Oh shit, it said I was supposed to heat sink that. Well, or put the shrink wrap on that. Well, that ain't gonna happen. I'm trying to see if there's anything that would like come into contact that could potentially cause me problems. I think it's gonna be all right. If you're making the mistake of following along with me as I try to do this, you wanna put your heat shrink on those two. Oh well, I think it's fine. I think it's okay. I think it's all right. I'm just gonna double check. Right. So it's basically saying, put the switch in first. Let me get the back part. Yes, the scientific name for this is the back part. Everyone knows that. I don't even know why I'm bothering to install. I'm pretty sure this battery is dead because it's the one that came with the pedal. Okay, shit. I have a lot of random components like just kind of surrounding me right now, and I'm like trying to figure out which is to which. So I need the little the washers and the nuts and stuff so I can get this little guy on. I'm missing a part. Here we go. I need more coffee. Put this on. I'm gonna try to put this on. So there's the switch. And I'm probably gonna just fast forward. Shit, did I mess this up? Because right now, all the wires coming off of this are kind of like bunching up, and it's making it so I don't have enough room to put the board back where it's supposed to be. So you can see my issue here. It would have been better for me to drill this hole higher up for sure. Yeah, I had more room here that I could have messed with. But I put it a little bit low, so what's happening is I have this little jumble here, right there, where this very, very thick wire, by the way, that came with the kit, and the end of that switch are butting heads with the circuit board. But I do have enough clearance, but it feels like I'm pretty close, so... if you could see where that switch is, yeah, you probably don't want to go any lower than that. If anything, I would try to maybe go a little bit higher. So I can feel this, the sustain one is getting pushed a bit by the wiring. And I also don't want there to be a lot of stress in that area, like push the circuit board or something. I don't feel like it's going to get a lot better than that. I think that's probably about as good as I'm going to get. I'm gonna hand tighten it for now, so that way I can pop it back open easy if I need to. The instructions were saying that if the sound like kind of flickers, then your soldering joints might be the issue. I feel like if anything I overdid it, but you know, anything can happen, especially the way that I fit it on there with this little... For now, I'm not even going to screw on the plate. I think I can just pop it right back on this thing. And yeah, let's go see if it even works. I have no idea, but fingers crossed. Quick little trial run before to see if it worked, and it seems like it was working. So I went ahead and just put the knobs back on, screwed it all back together. And this is why the Velcro was on there. It's just the stompbox pedal to my amp. So right now I'm just plugged in, cleaned. Nothing else is in. That's just a clean tone. That's the stomp box to go into my overdrive on my amp. But we're just gonna leave it clean. So this is all gonna be coming from the big muff. And right now when the switch is down like this, the way that I installed it, the tone should be disengaged. Yeah. Or the mod rather should be disengaged. So now I should be able to, yeah. The tone knob still lets me sweep. I'm just gonna go ahead and leave it at noon, and sustain is maxed out, right? So that's with the mod disengaged, and we're gonna go ahead and engage the mod. I did notice that the volume turns quite a bit up, so to make it similar to with the mod off, I am just going to turn the volume down and switch back and forth. So I feel like it's definitely a pretty noticeable difference, I think. You get a lot of that kind of scoopy sound. With the mod disengaged, it sounds... it sounds like your normal Big Muff. If we switch it, it just sounds like a more full sound. I'm gonna go ahead and turn the sustain down to like noon. So basically what I was saying before with the DS1 is I would normally, before I did the mod, I would use this little guy right here. And this is just what it sounds like by itself. So nothing too special. I mean, really what I'm using it for is mostly just to drive the mids right there. And when you turn this back on. It definitely opens up a different range of what you can do with this pedal for sure. Just completely bypassing this tone knob, I think, opens a lot of possibilities. Another thing that I used to do is I have a very cheap delay pedal here, but it seems to add a bit of treble. Even though I don't even think it's really doing a whole lot right now, because I think I have like the repeats basically all the way down. Okay, just a little bit. Like a little slap back. It's just a little bit more trebly, basically, with the, just a little bit of slapback. So yeah, for me, I feel like this was worth it, because I could have, you know, looked at getting other pedals entirely, or I can get this whole new added functionality out of just, you know, a couple parts. And you know, I think it took me like a total of an hour, maybe a little bit longer than an hour, you know, taking my time with filming and stuff. But it, all in all, it didn't take that long to do that. It wasn't super difficult. You know, I mean, you saw me struggling a bit, but having those directions definitely did help. Yeah, if you have this version, give it a shot. I mean, if you've done some soldering before, or even if you haven't and you have a soldering gun, you know, you could always just do like a little practice run on something. Like, they give you extra wires so you can like mess around with it just to see. And I noticed in the instructions too, they actually give you step-by-step instructions on how to solder. So even if you haven't soldered before, it kind of explains it. You can figure it out. I'm sure there's plenty of videos out there on how to, you know, solder and stuff. But I hope you found this useful, and follow for more if you like this kind of thing. I think I'm probably gonna do more mods on, I don't know. I'm just kind of getting into it, and I just wanted to, like, try different things out. But I know there's a lot of mods for the DS1, so I kind of want to mess with that. And I also got some new music coming out, so, yeah, stick around for that. But yeah, thanks for watching, and have a good one.